What's good, everybody? It's your host, Ed Blair, and this is the Ed Blair Podcast. I hope you had a good weekend. This episode is a very special episode because we have our first female guest on the show today, and I'm super excited. I won't talk you to death. I'll just let everything speak for itself. Ladies and gentlemen, we have Taria Billings on the show.
Thank you so much for having me.
You're welcome. How you doing?
I'm doing really well, you know, despite the circumstances, obviously, with our political and racial climate right now.
But. Yeah, it's definitely been crazy out here for sure, man. And I've just been at a loss for words with a lot of different things going on, to be honest with you. But I am happy you came. I was going to do something different, but it slipped my mind with you being the first female guest, but we'll still have a good time. I'll get right to it with you. I see that you were from Saginaw. Were you born and raised there?
Yep, born and raised in Saginaw, Michigan.
Okay, and then you relocated to Kalamazoo for like school or something?
Yeah, so I actually started my undergrad career at Alma College in Alma, Michigan. So it's about 15 minutes from Mount Pleasant.
Nice.
And so I was there for 2 years, and then I transferred to Western Michigan University my junior year.
Nice. Okay. Go Broncos. What did you major in?
So I majored in film, video, media studies.
Okay.
So that's what I got my bachelor's in, and I graduated in 2016.
Nice. All right. See, I knew that you were a director, filmographer, and all that stuff, but I wanted to slowly bring that in for the guests. You don't see too many black female directors and videographers and stuff like that. So that's why I wanted to keep it a surprise. We got one. So going back to the very beginning, I did see that you used to be a cheerleader. How long were you cheering for?
Oh, yeah, my cheerleading days. I started cheering my eighth grade year.
Okay.
And then I cheered all through high school, and then I did 2 years competitively in college at Alma, where after I left, we were second in the nation. And then they won their first national title in 2017.
Okay.
So they were back-to-back national champions in 2017 and 2018.
So, like, when you were cheering, did you ever get to experience, like, the competitions that they do? I think it's in Florida, right?
Yeah. Oh, so the most amazing, still to this day, the most incredible experience I've had, just competing on the band shell, you know, on the beach in front of, you know, hundreds and hundreds of other cheerleaders and teams, like rooting for you is just a surreal feeling.
That's what's up. Now, did you guys like win any of those competitions that you got to travel for?
Yeah, so our competitive season usually runs from about January, February till April, May, around there. So we would actually compete at NCAA Nationals in Daytona Beach, Florida.
Okay.
And then we also competed, it's a fairly new sport called stunt.
Okay.
And so it's a little less about, like, the choreography and the creative part of, you know, routines. And it's routines that you have to memorize, and you go against another team. You're doing the same routine, like, next to each other. And basically whoever does the routine the best, you know, gets the point. And then whichever team has the most points at the end of the round, you know, wins,
that's,
you know, that round. So, yeah, I love stunt. I love, like, the, you know, the dance and the acrobatic part of, you know, just the general competing, like, at NCAA. But stunt is definitely, I feel like, a little more, more of, I don't know, what I guess people would consider a sport, per se. Because, you know, people always, like, have the argument that cheerleading isn't a sport.
It definitely is. You go through training, you go through all types of stuff with it.
Oh, yeah. I would practice 3 hours every day on top of, like, regular workouts.
My
cheer literally consumed my life my first 2 years of college.
That's what's up. So did you ever, like, cheer for, like, Western or try out for Western or anything?
No. So I thought about trying out for their cheer team, but to my knowledge that they didn't compete when I was there. I think they have started competing recently, but they don't compete with NCAA. They compete with UCA, I think it's called. It was multiple different reasons why I didn't try out, but mainly I wanted to focus more on school and more on my craft. And it was just hard to divide my time between doing both. So I did end up coaching high school.
Okay.
During the rest of my time during undergrad. And then after I graduated, I cheered two seasons with a semi-pro team in Muskegon called the West Michigan Sparks.
Okay.
Yeah.
So let's talk a little bit about it. When you were coaching, like, what was the whole coaching experience like? And then, you know, how did your female athletes gravitate towards you as a coach?
So to them, they say that I was the first, like, real coach that they had. Mm-hmm. Like, I really pushed them, and I pushed their athletic capabilities. Like, I wanted us to stunt mm-hmm. and do all of the necessary strength building things you need to do to be a cheerleader. They were just used to just doing, like, cheers on the sideline. And I'm like, no, we're like,
not under
we're
me.
Going to be real, like, cheerleaders out here. So, I remember when we performed their homecoming routine, and a lot of parents came up to me and said, that was the most amazing routine I've seen Schoolcraft High School do. It's like, oh my gosh, like, that just made me feel really good.
And I bet.
Really great. And I was really proud of my girls. Like, they hit the routine, they didn't have any mess ups or anything. So, I was proud coach.
You said 2 years there?
Yep.
Okay. And then when you cheered semi-pro, what was that whole experience like?
That was also fun. So before then, I hadn't cheered for, 14? Like, almost 4 years. So I haven't, like, done any, like, stunting or, you know, tumbling or anything like that. So it was definitely exciting to kind of get back out on the field and do what I love. I definitely had to, like, relearn a lot of things.
Right.
But it's almost second nature. Like, it didn't take long to, like, get my body back in motion.
That's
so it definitely wasn't as hard as, you know, cheering in college as far as, like, the stunts go and stuff. But it was still a lot of fun. And ended up stopping after I kind of started my company and just got really busy. But
nice, okay.
But yeah, so.
That's what's up. Well, at least you got to live out, you know, like, something you were passionate about for as long as you did,
mm-hmm.
both as, like, a cheerleader and then a coach and then a semi-pro cheerleader.
Because, mm-hmm.
you know, for some people, after they graduate high school, that's it.
Yeah, like, that's true.
They don't get to go back to it. So how was it making the transition from Saginaw to Kalamazoo and then also balancing, like, being a student and coaching and, you know, being a semi-pro cheerleader on top of a business owner as well? Like, how were you able to maintain and balance all that you had going on at the time?
Yeah. A lot of people ask me that, and I never know, like, the best way to answer it.
Yeah.
I feel like there are definitely sectors of my life that kind of lack because I'm balancing so many things. So,
yeah.
Like, you know, my social life is pretty non-existent.
Yeah.
I don't get a lot of sleep, but I'm also a night owl, so it's not like I'm hurting from that or anything. But
yeah.
So, you know, those aspects. But as far as transitioning from Saginaw to Alma, Alma's like in the middle of nowhere. Like, cornfields, super tiny, small town, like, one gas station type of, like...
Oh, man. Yeah.
There's only a McDonald's and a Taco Bell and a KFC. And so, like, one of those. So it was definitely... There wasn't much to do at all off campus.
Yeah.
And so all of our entertainment was on campus. And then if you didn't have a car, then you were really just kind of, like, bored to death. Yes.
Yeah.
So... When I transitioned from Alma to Kalamazoo, it was just a complete 180. Like, Kalamazoo to me was probably, like, I don't know, New York City to, like, some people. And I was so excited to be here, and just it just seemed like it was a lot to do. And I really liked how much there was to do for people, like, involved in the arts.
Oh, yeah, it's definitely an artistic city.
I really appreciated that. So, yeah, I feel like now I'm, like, kind of getting used to it. I'm like, okay, I'm kind of ready to transition somewhere else. But
I feel that.
I feel like at the same time, Kalamazoo is a great place to grow a foundation and to really build a name for yourself. And that's what I've really been trying to work towards.
I feel that. Okay. So... With everything that you've encountered, you mentioned you have a business and, you know, you let what you were passionate about go for a minute to focus on another passion.
Mm-hmm.
What's the name of your business for those that don't know?
Yeah, so I started Reflect Media with my business partner, Monty Jones, in 2018.
Okay.
So before that, I was actually freelancing. Nice. I was freelancing, and then that kind of led me to start my company. And so Reflect is a docu-style storytelling company whose mission is to uplift stories about social justice, human rights, and the experiences of people of color. So we really aim to be a platform for marginalized voices and communities that are often, you know, silenced on the front lines for, you know, for justice and equality. And I really saw a need to have a space for, you know, people of color and marginalized folks to have a place to share their lived experiences.
Yeah.
Because oftentimes we're, you know, ignored or left at the margins, especially by mainstream media. So I really, especially now in like today's age.
Yeah.
And I also value like using art in an impactful way.
Yeah.
And so that's also why I wanted to really cater towards, you know, social justice stories by using film and media.
Nice. Well, I definitely, on behalf of our people, I appreciate what you do. I thank you for going out in the field, capturing the things that we may not see and hear about typically, like, because it's always overshadowed by nonsense, things that aren't relevant to us. So I appreciate the fact that you're bold and that you go out and, you know, you capture that. How many documentaries would you say you have under your belt so far?
Oh, wow. I feel like I do a lot of shorter works. Mm-hmm. So I do mainly a lot of promotional videos.
Okay.
For organizations and nonprofits that are rooted in social justice.
Okay.
And so I feel like I'm so busy doing client work that I don't have a lot of time to do my own creative projects.
Gotcha.
So a lot of my documentary work is client based.
Nice.
So I am hoping to like have a couple of my own documentary shorts or long version documentaries in the near future. But I do have a couple. One comes to mind, the story of Johnson Simon, Painting Dreams, the story of Johnson Simon. And that was actually the first documentary I ever created.
So that's your baby.
Yeah, that's my baby. I created that in 2015. Actually created it in an English class.
Okay, I was just gonna say you were still in school when you did that.
Yeah, so it was we had to do a genre project.
Oh,
and so we had to choose a genre and write a paper about the genre and then create like a project based on the genre that you chose. So I chose documentary. So I wrote a paper about like what documentaries are and stuff like that, and then I had to create an actual documentary.
That sounds like fun though. I love documentaries, like all types. Mm-hmm. Like mostly music ones is what I watch, because it's just something about going back to the roots of something before it became what it is at the current time. Like, I just like to see people, like, the hardships they went through, how they overcame it, and what made them the person that they are today, or what put them in the positions that they are in today. Like, I'm just fascinated with documentaries.
Absolutely.
What was the second one?
Another one that comes to mind, I do a lot of series.
Okay.
So like I have my Black Artist series.
I've seen those. Yeah.
Yeah. They're just highlighting, the stories of local Black artists.
Okay.
And their journeys.
I ain't got one. No, I'm just kidding.
I mean, I am looking for artists. I'm doing it blog style right now because of COVID and everything.
Yeah.
But yeah, I have another series about, talking about Black women and their breastfeeding journeys.
Okay.
So kind of trying to encourage more Black women to breastfeed.
Because
there's a health disparity there as far as Black women not breastfeeding as much as, you know, white women. Mm-hmm. And Black women aren't as, supported, you know, in that compared to white women. So just trying to, like, educate, you know, Black women of the importance of it.
It's definitely healthier. And because there's so many chemicals in baby food nowadays, and you never know what you're putting in the bottles and giving your baby. So I definitely understand that and support that wholeheartedly. So on this journey, when did you decide to pick up a camera, and what was the inspiration behind that?
So This is actually funny. So I was actually an environmental science major.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah. So growing up, I was really into science and nature. And I knew I wanted to do something like with animals or the environment or something around that field. And when I got to Alma, I was doing great in all my classes, except for when it came to biology. I don't know what it was about biology, but it's just nothing was clicking. College biology is a lot different than high school.
Yeah, for sure. It was part of one of my prereqs, and I'm like.
Yeah, so I ended up failing the class. And then so I was like, well, maybe environmental science isn't my calling. So then I switched to, I've always loved to write.
Okay.
So I switched to English for a while. Then I thought about education, and then I switched to political science, and then...
So it was just like a huge transition period for you, basically.
Yeah, I was
like,
just bouncing around trying to figure out what it is I wanted to do with my life.
Okay.
And then I took a new media studies class the second semester of my sophomore year and fell in love with it. I feel like I just really grasped on... I loved how hands-on it was and how I'd be able to kind of be creative and kind of give a visual representation of the stories that I wanted to tell and like to write. So that's when I decided that I was going to pursue like media in the film. And then it was on from there.
So. I dig it. That's actually what I went to school for as well. First, it was going to start off as business admin. Then I realized, do I really need a degree to start a business? Not really. So then I switched it. Then I went to journalism. Then it was cool, but at the same time, I didn't want to write for a paper or have a column in a magazine because that stuff's starting to fade out anyways.
Mm-hmm.
Everything's digitized now. So then I was like, film and TV media and film is what I want to do.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember taking the class in seventh or eighth grade when I went to Maple Street Magnet School. They had the class for it.
Okay.
And we had to make projects like you did.
Mm-hmm.
Write papers about them, and we learned how to use teleprompters, write out scripts. It was an awesome class, very hands-on. So that's why when I saw, you know, you were into it, like, it was easy for me to have you on the show. I was like, I could relate to that. So I wanted to bring you on and talk about it and see what your experience was.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah. So what would you say the reception was like for you when you first tapped into directing and filming and doing different projects?
It was definitely hard at first. So when I graduated in 2016, I could not find a job to say, like, I couldn't even get an interview.
Oh,
like,
man.
I literally applied, I know, well over, like, 200 job applications, just, like, all around.
And no bites, no leads.
No bites, no. I had a couple, but they weren't worth it enough to move.
Yeah.
Like, I didn't want to be like, you know, struggling artist sleeping in my car. Like, I didn't want to do that. I didn't want that for my life or for myself. And so I just decided, and that's when I decided, okay, well, no one will hire me, so I just gotta like do my own stuff, you know, until I can, you know, kind of get my name out there. So I kind of just started doing my own projects just on my own, reaching out to people. So I started a series about like social justice organizations in Kalamazoo. And I feel like that's what really kind of got my foot in. And so two out of the three organizations ended up hiring me. So the Society for History and Racial Equity, they ended up hiring me as like an independent contractor.
Yeah.
So I would go in and do like social media asset work for them. So creating like social media like videos or and stuff like that, or like doing photography at their events.
Nice.
And I was also on their marketing committee for the Summit on Racism annual conference that they have. And I did that for about almost 4 years. And then the ARCA Center for Social Justice Leadership, I did a video about them, and then they were actually really impressed and then hired me to do a second video, like a shorter video for their website.
Yes.
And so the ARCA Center was actually like my first like real client.
Mm.
And then from there, it just kind of like grew from that.
That's awesome.
But before that, it was really hard. And it's also like, and I did like freelancing for... you know, like TLC, HGTV, stuff like that.
Whoa.
Being on set as a production assistant. But I
remember you posted that you were on the set with Stanley Stubbs and Jeremy Cole for his show.
Yeah.
I used to work with Stanley, so
okay.
He's a good guy.
Yeah, he's awesome.
I thought that was good for you as well when I saw that, both of you actually, because I know film is what he's passionate about. He actually left the job we were at to pursue that. Mm-hmm. So that gave me the inspiration to step out on my own too. So like when I saw you two linked together, I just was like, oh, that's cool. I see we making moves out here.
Yeah.
But not to cut you off. Mm-hmm. I just thought about that. And then also too, like when you were speaking about the organizations and stuff, I just wanted to shout out the Save Our Children March that they got going on at Bronson Park. Mm-hmm. I started about an hour ago, but still, I'll give them a shout out.
Oh, nice.
So I just wanted to mention that that was going on and also acknowledge the different things going on today with the basketball tournament, everything else to keep the shootings and crimes down. I do appreciate the efforts. I just wanted to throw that in there. But
absolutely.
So as far as things of that nature, I have seen you around town filming and capturing things like that. Are you a photographer as well?
So I actually just got into photography recently. So I wouldn't consider myself a photographer like I do, like a videographer, right, or a filmmaker, but I can take photos, if that makes sense. Like people have hired me to like take photos at events or at weddings and stuff like that.
Yeah, weddings too. Okay.
I don't do them anymore. So don't ask me. But I did in the past. It was just too stressful.
Gotcha.
But yeah. So I want to backtrack a little bit and add to my other point. But yeah, when I was on set for those channels, I kind of, like being a production assistant, I just realized that I do not want to do this. Because, I mean, in the film world, you kind of have to start off at the bottom and work your way up.
Yeah.
And I was just like, I don't want to carry around cables all day for two, three years or however long it would take. And I know people do it. Like, I know Lena Waithe did it. Like, she did it for, like, almost 10 years before she finally got, like, you know, a writing gig and eventually, like, has her show.
You kind of don't have to, you know? Like,
yeah.
It's just a matter of picking up the camera and just taking initiative.
Exactly.
Getting, you know, filming whatever you want to film.
And that's the route that I decided to take. I'm like, I have a camera. I can just make my own stuff.
Right. Well, good for you. I'm happy you did that. Because it's 2020.
Exactly.
You gotta do all that. Now, as far as, you know, the projects you've already done, is there anything that you would like to tap into that you haven't done? Like, do you want to shoot movies maybe, or do music videos maybe? I don't know. Are you interested in anything outside of documentaries?
Mm-hmm. I've been thinking about that, thinking about expanding and trying to branch outside of documentaries.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know. I'm kind of the person that likes to be really good at a couple of things versus being okay at a lot of things.
Yeah.
And so I know documentaries is what I'm good at.
Yeah.
It's where my passions lie. So I feel like it would be a disservice for me not to, you know, focus all my energy into that.
Okay.
But I've definitely, like, I've helped friends, like, on sets for, like, fiction films or short films and stuff like that. So I definitely like to be around and in that environment.
Yeah.
But as far as, like, trying to make a Hollywood feature or anything like that, that's not really in my plans.
I understand. Now, have you ever went to any film festivals? Like, I know South by Southwest is a big music festival, but they're also a big film festival as well. Like, I don't know if you ever heard of it, but have you ever went to any of those or submitted anything to any of the film festivals, IFC festivals?
No, not the big ones yet. Definitely in my 10-year plan. I've only submitted and been at the local festivals, like, around Michigan.
What were some of those?
The Public Media Networks.
I heard of them.
North by Midwest.
Okay.
Micro Budget Film Fest, I think is what it's called. And then they had another film festival last year, something about raising your voices. I forgot the name of the festival.
Mm-hmm.
But it's funny because I almost didn't go to the screening because I had been, like, really sick that week.
Oh, wow.
And I almost didn't go, but, like, I was feeling well enough to, like, just get by.
Mm-hmm.
So, but I'm glad I went because I actually ended up winning Best of Show and Best Documentary. Yeah, it was really exciting. That was my first That was my first film festival win, like in general, anyway. Yeah. And to get best of show, like, and best in the category, like,
that's
I was really
big,
excited.
Especially for somebody doing it independently.
Thank you. Yeah. So it was kind of the affirmation I needed that I was heading in the right direction.
Awesome. Now, do you have any aspirations to have like your own production studio, like a big studio where you do bigger documentaries and maybe have people work under you and you can like provide the opportunity for other up and coming directors or something?
Yeah, I've also been thinking about that. Mm-hmm. I'm starting to question if film is my passion or if storytelling is. I often tell people that I'm a storyteller. Yeah. Film just happens to be the medium.
Yeah.
And the medium that I use the most. But I mean, whether that's through writing or through working with organizations or things like that, I just love to amplify and uplift voices. And so I feel like lately I've been doing a lot of like more work like around the community and community voices and less like in actual film production. So like I don't know if that's like something I want to like pursue.
Understood.
Or like, so I don't know, we'll see.
We'll have to wait and see. Now with you being a writer, do you write poetry, songwrite, anything like that, or are you just writing stories in general? What would you—
I used to be an avid poet. Like, I used to write poetry like it was my job, mainly in like middle school and high school. I wrote a lot of poetry.
Okay.
And then I had stopped writing and started writing more like short stories and things like that.
Gotcha.
And then as I got to college and like in grad school and stuff, I just been writing more like academic works.
Yeah.
And then been freelancing for like local publications and things like blogs and things like that. So
that's what's up.
I feel like my writing has elevated as I've grown older. So, and I mean, it might be weird, but like I love writing papers. I love writing like for academic journals and stuff like that.
Yeah. I like to write too. It's something about songwriting for me that's like very therapeutic. Like storytelling through songwriting is like the most amazing thing ever. Cause like you can't always talk to everybody about everything, and not everybody's gonna understand how you feel or what you're thinking or what you're going through. But if you got that pen and pad, there's endless possibilities and there's no limits as to what you can say on that paper.
Mm-hmm.
So I definitely understand. And I write poems as well. I haven't performed at any poetry since the Put Up or Shut Up's been—
I used to love going to the Put Up or Shut Up.
That's where all my friends and connections came from.
Oh,
so,
my gosh, man. Yeah. Good times.
I still got a few pictures from when I went up and did my thing. Did you have a poet name?
No. I never performed. Like, gotcha. I never did the spoken word thing, but I loved going.
You got the voice for it.
Oh, thank you. Maybe one day, but I'm really bad at memorizing stuff, so I would have to read off of, you know.
So you don't you haven't memorized any of your old poems at all?
I did write one song before.
Okay.
I can't sing, though. I don't know why I wrote a song. But
it'd be like that. I can't sing either, but I could write the hell out of an R&B song for sure. Like, I don't— I like to play like I can, though. I'll cut you a demo. I'll be feeling myself on a demo, too. But so would you ever consider maybe writing, like, children's books or writing a book in general?
Mm-hmm. I actually did write a children's book and got it published. I wrote it originally when I was in fifth grade.
Wow.
It's called The Monster in the Basement.
That's what's up.
And then I got it published when I was in 10th grade through Author House Self-Publishing Company.
So it's still for sale. Like, people can find it and still buy it.
It's online, but I only sell them, like, by hard copy.
Got you.
So, I mean, people still ask me about it and stuff. But,
yeah,
so technically I am, like, a published author.
You are. And it started at an early age. Mm-hmm. So that right there shows that you were destined for greatness. So the type of things that you've done already and are currently doing, that's what set you aside from others. Like, you've— from an early age, you were just destined to be the person you are now.
Yeah, I appreciate that.
No problem. So I would definitely say your parents did a good job. Shout out to them.
They are very proud.
That's what's up. So, are you gonna publish another book maybe in the future?
I would like to. I don't know about what yet, but I definitely would want to. It would probably be like more of like a memoir style.
Okay.
That
would be lit.
Nonfiction. So sticking with the nonfiction theme of, like, you know, documentary and stuff.
So. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now, do you have a favorite author?
I mean, I love Angie Thomas. Mm-hmm. Love Angela Davis. I just read this book called Heavy by, I hope I'm saying his name right, Key Essay Layman.
Okay.
Probably the best book I've read, definitely this year, if not ever. Black Boy by Richard Wright is another one of my favorites.
Both by him, right? The same author?
Nope. So Heavy was written by Key Essay. And then Black Boy was written by Richard Wright.
Okay, Richard Wright.
Yeah, I love Richard Wright. James Baldwin, of course, another one of my favorites.
He does a lot of the social injustice books, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What are some others? That's so many. I have a library at home, so.
That's what's up. Mm-hmm. It's definitely healthy to read, I would say, for sure. Definitely broadens your horizons and opens that third eye to things that you may not think about often.
Mm-hmm.
So I definitely, you know, suggest sometimes people turn off the TV or put the tablet or phone down and read a little bit.
Yeah.
Even if it's just a few pages a day.
Exactly. I definitely have been reading more since, like, the coronavirus and stuff. Just because I've had time to just be at home. And
yeah. I feel like it forced a lot of people to, like, mellow out. Like, most of us that are always on the go, constantly doing something and have to be busy all the time, it forced us to take a breath and sit back and just focus on what we have in front of us.
Yeah,
and
that was hard for me at first. Like, at first, I was struggling. But now I am grateful for the break.
Yeah, absolutely. Because you got to rejuvenate and give your body a rest and your mind a rest. And in order to stay healthy and be able to perform at your peak, you know, you gotta take necessary breaks, or your body will just do it for you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's very true.
Now, let's see. You just got so much to talk about. What would you say your plan for, like, the next 5 years would be as a businesswoman? And let's say you got everything that you want to do going for yourself and you're succeeding with everything. Like, what would the next step be? Where do you see yourself 5 years from now?
That's a good question. Definitely, I feel like reflect is something that I will always do as a side thing. I don't think I'll ever be a full-time entrepreneur.
Yeah.
I mean, I have done that, but it was definitely too stressful and too much to. I felt like I was taking on projects and clients not because I was invested in the work, but because I, like, for a paycheck. You know, it was my way of living, and so I didn't like feeling like I had to depend on, you know, my passion for income. It just made me lose, like, the excitement out of it.
It takes away from it.
Yeah, doing it for money and not doing it because I want to. So that's when I decided to get, like, you know, a big girl job and just do reflect on the side. And since then, I have definitely regained my passion and my love for film and storytelling.
That's good.
And then I also don't feel like I have to take on every single project, you know, make sure I'm getting a check, you know, in the mail. So definitely having Reflect as a side thing. But, I mean, right now I'm working in communications at a social justice organization. And so I think I want to continue doing that type of work. So doing communications or multimedia for, like, a nonprofit or organization that is social justice based.
Yeah.
And so I actually have been interviewing for some positions outside of Michigan.
Okay.
So I hope to be out of Michigan within the next year or so.
That would be awesome.
So we'll see. And then I love to teach. And that's something I kind of found out in grad school when I was a TA. And I was teaching undergrad classes during my master's program.
You can't just glide past that. Say that one more time. What was you doing?
I was a graduate teaching assistant. So I was teaching undergrad students during my master's program.
Okay. I just wanted, for the people in the back that ain't hear what you said.
And I absolutely loved that. The thing I loved most about it was just being, like, a mentor for first-generation Black students and students of color in general, but just being that representation that they may not, you know, have always seen or have had, you know, in their college experience. And just being that for them just really I don't know. It filled my heart with so much joy. Yeah. And I definitely would want to do something like that long term.
Okay.
So teaching is definitely on the horizon. I plan on starting my PhD next year. So I'm submitting
Dr.
PhD. Yeah.
Okay. Dr. Billings.
Dr. Billings.
Put some respect on her name.
Respect. Yeah. So teaching, reflect on the side, and then working at an organization doing communications.
Okay. Well, thank you again for all your hard work. We definitely appreciate that. Along our journeys, we do go through hardships, and there's things that we have to overcome. What would you say some of your most challenging things you had to encounter were?
I think just staying the course. Mm-hmm. Like I said, in 2016, I had a hard time finding a job. And during that time, I kind of felt like I did everything right. So I didn't understand why it was so hard for me to, you know, be hired. You know, I was involved, heavily involved in school. I did a million zillion internships. Like, I've interned probably everywhere in Kalamazoo that you can, like,
okay,
doing film and media stuff. And, you know, I had a decent work sample reel. And so I just didn't understand, you know, what it was that I was missing or what it was that I lacked that other people didn't. Mm-hmm. And so I actually got into a really depressive state pretty much from, like, January through, like, March of 2017,
mm-hmm,
before I finally just kind of picked myself up. And like I said, I had a camera. I didn't have a lot of equipment then. I just had a camera that my parents bought. God bless them. Appreciate them so much. And I had, like, a basic microphone and, a real janky tripod. And I was just making stuff. And,
that's all you need.
Yeah, so just like I said, staying the course and then staying the journey and also not comparing your journey to others.
Yes, that's
that
a big
will
one.
Definitely kill you. Like, and I know that's hard to do. It's easier said than done, but really just realizing that your journey is yours and that, you know, everything happens for a reason. And then looking back now, mm-hmm, I feel like everything had to happen the way it did for me to be where I am right
exactly.
now.
Exactly. And when people compare their journey to other people's journeys, they never take time to think about what that other person may have went through in order to achieve the success that they have at that moment. Mm-hmm. You never know. Because,
mm-hmm,
of course, we never will show you, like, yeah, this was the depressing side of my life while I was pursuing this and I had to go through all this. Mm-hmm. We're not going to show you that. We're just going to show you the highlight of our career and the upside of it.
Mm-hmm.
So you can't base, you know, your experience off somebody else's because you don't know the full backstory.
Exactly.
And then also, it just may not be your time right then and there. And I don't know if you're religious or not, but I'm a firm believer that everything happens for a reason and God will bless you with what your calling is when it's time.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah. Four years ago, like, I definitely wasn't ready. Like, as much as I wanted to think that I probably was, like,
it just wasn't.
Yeah, it wasn't time. And like now I feel like it's time now to expand and grow.
Yeah. Well, I'm happy with everything that you're doing and what you're involved in. And, you know, you are setting good examples. So I'm happy that, you know, you took a different route and, you know, you're someone that our younger generation can look up to. That's pretty amazing to me. So where can people find you on social media?
Yeah, so I am everywhere. Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, Instagram. So you just do @ and then Tirea B, TirreaB. And that's for all my social media. So, and then my website is TireaB.com.
And do you have, like, merch or anything like that?
No merch.
Not yet.
I'm not that fancy yet.
We get there. Baby steps. It takes time. Now, is there anything currently in the works for you?
In the works. Not off. Oh, well, actually, okay. So I started a prison education program focusing on media and storytelling this summer. It's called Seeing Through the Bars.
Oh, okay.
And so it's a program that really teaches and shows inmates the power of media and the importance of storytelling and using your voice to drive social change.
Mm-hmm.
And so how it works is the people who are incarcerated at Gus Harrison Correctional Facility, that's who we're working with, they're partnered with someone who's on the inside. on the outside, excuse me. And they communicate through JPay, which is like the email service that like most prisons use. And so the prompt was, how has your experience with prison, like how has COVID affected your, you know, life in prison? And so from that, the people on the inside, the people who are incarcerated, they are writing like stories based on that prompt. And then they send it to their partner who's on the outside, and that person takes that story and creates a media project out of it. Okay. So it can be like a music video or a documentary or a photo series or anything like that. And then so we're going to have our virtual showcase on September 9th, which is the anniversary of the Attica prison uprising.
Okay.
And so, yeah, I'm really excited about that, just to show, you know, the stories of these people, to kind of humanize them and show that, you know, incarcerated lives matter too.
Oh, yeah.
And conditions in prisons definitely need to change.
Yes, it's been a problem for quite some time, especially down south. I remember last year there was an uproar about the conditions of Mississippi prisons. Mm-hmm. They were like really, really bad. People were dying because of the conditions. Mm-hmm. All types of crazy stuff was going on.
Yep.
I remember hearing about that. And now that we got COVID and it's not making it any better, I don't know if they changed those conditions or not, but it's just so many people that are affected by that and so many prisons that are janky.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a sad topic all around.
Yeah, like, yeah.
And then it's like they treat the inmates like they're not people because they committed crimes and did different things. But it's like it's not fair to them. You know?
Mm-hmm.
I don't agree with that.
Yeah. So.
Absolutely. Well, I appreciate that you're, you know, bringing awareness to these different things. You definitely mentioned some things that the listeners and viewers probably weren't hip to. So that's good that they can go research that and check that out.
Mm-hmm.
You mentioned some politics. I typically don't dive too far into it.
I'm not like really well versed or educated in politics like that, but I have my opinions.
Well, share them. That's what we're here for. Go ahead and throw them out there.
Oh, there's so many things wrong. I mean, first of all, like the two-party system has to go. Like it's just old and outdated. Can I cuss on here?
Yeah.
Fuck Trump. Like, honestly, point blank, period.
Fuck Trump.
And I mean, I know Biden also isn't. I guess I'm tired of having to pick the lesser of two evils.
Yeah, it's like you got Satan and then you got Satan's advocate. And then it's like, which devil do you choose? Hell, I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely. My personal choice would have been Bernie Sanders, but you know, politics. So.
Yeah, he. I don't feel like he had his fair shot.
He didn't.
Any time that he ran, I don't think he got a fair shot. But then again, you got to think he is up there in age, and
they all are.
Yeah, but Bernie is like
super old.
Yeah, I don't know. I respect the OG though.
Mm-hmm.
Sure. Yeah, it's 2020 has just been one big clusterfuck.
Oh yeah, rest in peace, Chadwick. Oh yes. My gosh, I was so devastated last night when I read that.
It was just so random too. Like I didn't know he had colon cancer, and I'm just scrolling Twitter, and then next thing I know, I see everybody RIP, and I'm like.
I saw it on Instagram. I just saw like people posting his picture, and I was like, "Oh, okay, he must be in a new movie or something." I wasn't reading the caption.
They talked about Black Panther 2, so I'm like, "Okay, maybe they promoting that."
Yeah, and then I was like, "Oh my gosh, I still can't believe it."
Yeah, me neither. Hopefully, Marvel leaves that alone. Just put out Black Panther 2, and then just leave that be.
Yeah, because they can't. There's no way you can. Mm-mm. No one else can play Black Panther. Like that's just
nah.
Yeah.
Just like it's weird they got somebody else playing Blade in a new movie, and I'm like, Wesley did that. Like, let's move forward.
Right.
Nah, but is there anybody you would like to work with as far as any of your professions? Like, you know, maybe like co-write something, co-produce something.
Mm-hmm. I mean, Ava DuVernay is my idol. So if I could ever work with her in any type of capacity, like that would just make my whole day.
Okay.
Or my whole life, really. She, like, I really aspire to be. I don't know. She drives and motivates me so much in a lot of the work that I do, and I just love what she represents. She was really the person that inspired me to, you know, dedicate my company to what it's for, you know, specifically for, you know, telling stories of injustice and to uplift marginalized voices. So, yeah, shout out to Ava.
Shout out to Ava. I know you said you read. Have you ever heard of a book called From the Broader Files?
No. What's that about?
Basically, I hear a lot of people talk about it. I haven't looked too far into it, so I was just going to ask if you read it to see if you could educate me on it. I don't know. I just hear a lot about the author, Anthony T. Browder, and then I was going to ask you if you knew who he was as well. So I guess maybe that can be something we learn together.
Yeah, I'll put that on my reading list.
Yeah.
What is it called again?
From the Browder File.
From the Browder File, okay.
By Anthony T. Browder.
Is that about the guy that committed suicide from being at the prison? You know what I'm talking about? I forgot his name.
I know what you're talking about. Yeah. I think so. Let me see. I think that is what that was. I might have to look that up. So what books would you recommend to our listeners and our viewers that you like personally? I know we went through authors that you like, but what books would you recommend?
Heavy, as I mentioned before. Just Mercy by Bryan Stevenson.
Mm-hmm.
What else? I have so many. Sorry, I'm gonna look in my.
It's all right.
My list of books.
Because you know, there's book clubs out there still. So people probably looking for new things that they might want to read, different things.
Becoming by Michelle Obama, of course.
Okay.
Shout
out to her. They did do a documentary on her on Netflix.
Yeah. So amazing.
That's still our first lady.
Right. Yep. It's still so poised. What are some other books? I have so many that it's hard to like think of one off top, but definitely Just Mercy and Heavy.
Okay. That's
and then I'm reading a book right now by Angela Davis. I can't remember.
I love documentaries about her. I've watched many different things about her, and her story was incredible to me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
she is. I don't know, that might be something you might have to cover one day.
A powerhouse.
So this is a question I typically ask artists when they come on the show, but I'm going to flip it up for you.
Mm-hmm.
What would you say your top five Black leaders are? Instead of MCs, I'm going to say Black leaders.
Black leaders, top five. No particular order, but Ava DuVernay, of course, Michelle Obama, Angela Davis. Need two more. Tyler Perry.
Okay.
And... one more Black leader.
I'll just say you, Miss Billings. I put you up there.
trying to think of. I don't want to say anyone like cliche.
Yeah, that's understandable. Just people that you're influenced by, like people that made an impact on you.
Mm-hmm.
It's different for everybody.
Her name is Dr. Sarah Jackson.
Okay.
She is a professor at University of Pennsylvania.
Oh, okay.
Which is actually where I want to go to school.
Penn State?
Yeah.
Okay.
University of Pennsylvania.
Oh, yeah. Different.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
I get them mixed up too. No, it's okay. It's okay. But I actually referenced a lot of her work in my master's thesis. So, like, if I could work under her, that would be incredible. So she just inspires me, and I don't know. I want to be just like her as a professor.
That's what's up.
So, like, she's kind of, like, kind of famous in the, like, academia world. So.
Oh, that's what's up. Mm-hmm. Well, you might exceed being like her and be better than her. So we'll speak that into existence.
Yes. Thank you.
No problem. So in closing, is there anything you want to get off before we close? Like, you want to throw anything out there, drop a bombshell, anything? Shout out anybody?
Man, I just want to encourage people to continue to pursue your dreams and your passions, no matter what they are. There are going to be so many people and roadblocks and things that will try to deter you from your path, but it's so important to stay the course and do what, like, brings you joy. Like, do something or pursue something that makes you excited to, like, wake up in the morning. And I have definitely been, like, a firm believer. And I've also been a firm believer in patience and growing where you are planted. Because, like I said, like, the journey may not always be what you plan or expect it to, but it's still your journey, and you should embrace it and accept the things that, you know, come your way. And don't get discouraged. And seek community, like, seek, like, mentorship. Talk to people who are better than you and have more experience than you, and and seek that help, because you definitely can't do it alone.
No.
And yeah, just continue the fight. You know, hopelessness is the enemy of justice, and so it's always important to, like, remain hopeful, especially if you're doing, like, social justice work or work of around anything around, like, injustice in general. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah. That's what I would encourage people to remember.
You heard it here first on the Ed Blair podcast. That was Miss Billings. I appreciate you for coming today.
Thank you again for having me.
Oh, no problem. It's been an honor and a privilege. You're more than welcome to come back anytime. And I look forward to seeing, you know, the elevation and everything that you do. And you got my full support, and as well as my fans, subscribers, and viewers' full support. And signing off.
Thank you again.
No problem.